I go to In-N-Out. I order the same thing on a regular basis. You know, give me a, you know, double-double animal style, you know, with chopped chilies on it, fry light, okay? And that's just how I roll, okay? And then yet, with all of that said, there's still room for change. Yet not all change is good. Now, change, according to the dictionary, has many definitions. It's to substitute or transfer. It's to exchange or to switch. As a verb, it means to become different, to alter or vary. It's to pass from one phase to another. And that's what we like. See, we like change, to become different, you could say, to move on to another phase. Us guys like changing what we drive. You know, we buy a new car with more power. But then we change everything about the car when we buy the car. We change the wheels and the tires, you know. We change things about it. If certain cars we want to lower, other cars we want to lift up higher. All of these different things. We change the exhaust. We add things to them. But of course, you girls, you are notorious for change also. Especially in the looks department. It amazes me as you can have it all going on. Like, you just got it all going. You're looking good. Everything's good. But that's not good for you, because one day you'll wake up. And all of a sudden, for no apparent reason, you think it all needs to change. And off to the mall you go. And as guys call it for an overhaul, you call it a makeover. Okay, whatever. Whatever. First, you change your hairstyle. That might not be enough. You change the color of your hair. Then you hit the MAC counter. You know, you have a whole makeup change. And then you look in your closet and you decide that your entire wardrobe overnight has become hopeless. You need new everything. Yes, we all like change. And sometimes one change can transform your entire life. Consider Cinderella. One shoe allowed her story to end with "they lived happily ever after." I wonder how many of you girls here would like to have that one shoe. But that's a whole nother story. We'll look at that another time. Yes. But moving on, we have reelected our president. He promised change. And if we give him more time, he's going to make that change. Okay, we gave you 4 years. You didn't make the change. Okay, you need another 4. Okay, we gave it to you. All right. Stop talking about change and start making the change. See, the changes that were promised is going to have to be change that is made. See, the kind of change that this country needs is going to take more than just talk. It was Brian Nelson that said this quote, "You can hold a dollar bill in your hand, but it will not turn into 4 quarters. If you want change, you have to make it happen." Yes, we're all faced with change. Many want to change their diet and lose weight. But the only problem with that is 41% of Americans say they can't change their ice cream cravings. Okay, so it's like we want change, but we can't really change the change. Maybe that would describe you. Yes, there is change all around us. Time changes. When we move, we have to have a change of address. For young mothers, there's always another diaper to change. We change direction. We can change our opinion. If we go to In-N-Out, we can change your order. And by the way, I got a pet peeve here. If you're at In-N-Out and you're ordering, don't look at the menu for 20 minutes. It's not that hard. I mean, it's just like, and I'm like behind them, like, it's one patty or two. Do you want cheese or not? I mean, it's not that hard. It's just, you know, just figure it out. It's not complicated. But anyway, I feel better now. It's off my chest. I feel lighter now. I feel like light on my toes. Anyway, and then there are those things that we want to change, but for whatever reason, we cannot. Viktor Frankl said this quote, "When we no longer are able to change a situation, we are challenged to change ourselves." And last but not least, living in this day and age, a time when we're filled with uncertainty and there's hardship always pressing against us, it seems to be the only thing on the horizon is, you know, like what's going to happen next. I love the hope of the eternal living God, the one who never changes. He's given us his unchanging word also. And this is what he says in his unchanging word by the unchanging God. Psalm 46:1, when desperation hits us, it says, "God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth should change." Because things are going to change. Circumstances will turn sour. But God says, even though the world will change, I will not change. and we can find our refuge and strength in Him. Yes, we are faced with many changes, and this morning, as we continue in this study through the book of 1 Corinthians, as you remember from last week, we looked at power, and we saw that there is power in unity. See, God did not intend His church to be divided, but rather God intended His church to be united. Then we looked at the power in the cross. Yes, the power of the gospel is in the power of the cross. The fact that Jesus came to the earth to save sinners. He bore our sin upon His body. And so that those of us who believe and receive Jesus into our hearts as our Savior, as our Messiah, those who believe Jesus came and that He lived as a man, not just any man, the God-man, and that He died on the cross, that He was buried in a grave, and that He rose again from the dead. If we embrace that, and we believe that, and we receive that, then we are forgiven. And finally, last week, we looked at the power in weakness. We saw that God has chosen us, that He's chosen us. That word chosen we looked at in the original Greek means that He made us His first pick. We are God's first pick. He has chosen us. And He says He has chosen the foolish things of the world. We looked at that word foolish, and we realized that it came from the Greek word moron, where we get our English word moron, okay? And of course, it is there described and translated as the word blockhead. So God has chosen the foolish things of the world, the blockheads of the world, to do what? To shame the wise, to shame the skilled experts. And though we are weak and feeble at times, God can and will use us to shame the mighty and the strong. Is that not an encouraging thing? God never asks us to be strong in our own strength. He never said, come and serve me, all you who are strong in your own strength. No, He says, come unto me, all you that are weak and feeble. Come to me, all you that are foolish, all you that don't have it all figured out, all of you that don't know what the right answer is, and I will use you to confound those that are strong, those that are mighty. That's what God has promised to us. And now this morning, as we continue this chapter-by-chapter study through God's Word, we will consider three different points in light of our title, Change. Number one, a change in speech. Number two, a change in wisdom. And number three, a change in spirit. Now let's look at our first point here, a change in speech, as we read together, starting in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 1. The reason that we're there is because we left off in chapter 1, verse 31, which was the end of that chapter. So we pick up where we left off. Yet? Aha. You know, it's not that I loved listening to myself, but I'm thinking like, did something just happen? You know, it's like, but I'm just going on and on and on. Okay. But you still heard the word, right? You heard it. Okay, good. All right. But again, Paul did not come to them in superiority of speech, but rather he came determined to know nothing except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Know this, the Apostle Paul had come a long way in his walk with the Lord, because this is not the same man who first encountered the Lord on the road to Damascus. He's been changed. Something's happened with this man. For like us, anyone who comes into a relationship with Jesus, it should be a life-altering change. It should be a life-changing transformation. In fact, that word transformation comes from the Greek word metamorpho, which means a metamorphosis happens to us. You know, it's like when a caterpillar turns into a butterfly. You start off one thing, but really you turn into something really completely different. It's a metamorphosis. And that's what should be happening to us. Now, I can only speak for myself. But when Jesus came into my life, he changed my entire course and direction. He started on the inside, and he was working things out to the outside. Meaning, at first, you couldn't really see much change in my life. I remember when I made my first stand for Jesus. In fact, it really wasn't much of a stand. I failed miserably. Miserably failed. I remember this person wanted me to put a Jesus bumper sticker on my car, and I'm thinking, not really. Okay. See, my wife, when she became a believer, she just like, we had this little mini truck, this little Ford Courier, and she wanted, I mean, it's like a billboard on the thing. It was like, Jesus lives, okay? I mean, she just like, she wanted the huge bumper sticker. But me, when I first became a believer, I'm just kind of like thinking, not really. I don't want to put like a bumper sticker on my car. So they had these multiple stickers for me to pick from. I'm like, oh, go ahead. I'm like, all right. I found the smallest one. It was only like this big. And all it said was, in God we trust. And so I put it on the car, like, fine, it's on the car. And the very next day, not 2 weeks later, not like a month later I forgot about it. No, the next day, when I'm still thinking about it, I worked at Ontario Honda, and I always wanted to hang out with the mechanics. The mechanics were so cool, you know. They had tattoos, you know. They just, you know, seemed to have it all together. I worked in the parts department. Here, do you need a spark plug? You know, it's just like, you know, but the mechanics, they were ripping engines apart. They were like real men, you know. And it's like, so they asked me to go to lunch with them one day. And I'm like, I get to go to lunch with the mechanics, you know. And there I am with the mechanics. I'm walking behind them, you know. And we're walking by my car because we're going to take another guy's car. And all of a sudden, the one mechanic goes, what is that? And I'm like, who put that on my car, you know? And they're looking at me. They all look at the bumper sticker, then they're all looking at me like, what is that? And I'm like, you know, in God we trust, we all pay cash. And they said, all right. And then they all walk, and I'm like, oh. I was just so bummed. I'm just like, I totally wormed out. Totally just was a total worthless anything. I'm thinking, oh, God is certainly going to forsake me now because I've denied his name. I mean, I was just a mess after that. And I decided, you know, never again am I going to deny what God is doing in my life. Yes, I was a work in progress. And I still am today. You know, it's not like, oh, I'm the pastor, so I've got all these areas figured out. Now, I have figured out some areas, but I do not have all areas figured out. I mean, there's still areas that I struggle in and still areas that I have to work on in my life, even as I'm sure you do. But let me ask you, have you allowed God to work in your life? Have you allowed him to change you? If there's an area in your life that God has bring to the forefront of your mind, it's like, are you allowing him to change that area in your life? And if not, why not? Because it can't just be, I'm going to be a church-going Christian on Sunday, and then yet on Monday we do something completely different. You ever see the car salesman who's like, oh, yeah, as soon as they hear that you're a Christian, oh, I'm a praise Jesus, brother, how are you? You know, and it's just like everything is like gone on and everything. I have sold things to people and they say, oh, yeah, you know, they want a better deal because they find out I'm a Christian. Oh, you're a pastor, make me a better deal. And I'm selling a car or something. And then they'll want me to lie about how much I'm selling them the car for so that they won't have to pay as much tax. And I'll say, well, hey, listen, bro, I'm sorry, man. That's the price. And that's, you know, I'm not gonna lie. I can't make out the bill of sale for less. He goes, well, what does it matter to you? And I say, it matters because it's the truth. And so I won't lie about how much I sold the car for. And it's like, I've even taken less money off the car. He's like, well, man, I don't want to buy it then. I've even lowered the price some to help cover their tax. But I'm not going to lie about how much I sold the car for. Well, getting back to Paul, he allowed God to change him. And that's why he was able to say what we just read. Let's look back for just a moment on how Paul started as a Christian. This will give us a little bit more insight on how far Paul had actually come. Listen to his own words in Philippians 3:5 when he was describing kind of the guy he used to be. He says, I was circumcised on the eighth day of the nation of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin. I was a Hebrew of Hebrews. According to the law, I was a Pharisee. As to the zeal that I had, I was a persecutor of the church. As to the righteousness which is found in the law, I was found blameless. But whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as loss for the sake of Christ. And I count them but rubbish in order that I may gain Christ. Now, the reason I teach out of the New American Standard is because it's the most accurate translation of the original Greek and Hebrew scriptures into the English language. That's why I teach from the New American Standard Bible. But sometimes the King James Bible actually has a better translation of a particular word. And where they use, I count all these things as rubbish in a New American Standard, the King James actually has it as a more correct translated word, which is, I count all my past as dung, he said. And I count it. He goes, it's as dung in order that I may gain Christ. Yes, Paul had quite the resume, you could say, from his life, from the youth. He was lived by the letter of the law, he did. I mean, Paul was raised under the law. He was of the tribe of Benjamin. And that was one of the elite of the 12 tribes of Israel. You remember Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Jacob had 12 sons, and those were the 12 tribes of Israel. Well, his two favorite sons were, of course, Joseph and Benjamin. And so he was of the tribe of Benjamin, and he considered himself a Hebrew of Hebrews, meaning he lived it out. He spoke the Hebrew language, and he lived by and according to the law of God. He was a Pharisee. That was the highest order of religion of the time. This all meant that he was a proud, yet lost, legalistic man of Judaism. Now, according to Paul, his righteousness was found blameless. He was found blameless. See, the Pharisees tried to live a life of outward works to be seen and to justify themselves before God as they lived it out in front of other people. So Paul is saying, look, you know, I lived out my life in front of all men. So when they looked at me, they only saw the good. So I was blameless is what he's saying. Now, was Paul actually blameless in his life? No, not at all. No man is blameless before God. Why? Because the Bible says that God looks in through everything we've done. It's like a clear transparency. He sees everything. So though we can appear that we look blameless, we are not blameless. And Paul knew that and understood that. Because no one can be blameless because God sees it all. We looked at all at Lance Armstrong, did we not? And he won 7 Tour de France. I was like, I mean, me and my wife used to watch every leg of those things. And I mean, we were rooting for him. Go America, go Lance Armstrong, woohoo. You know, it's like all that. And all, it was all a lie. And now it's all coming out. Now he has to go on Oprah and he has to, you know, tell the world that he lied, that, you know, all these people that were saying all along that he was doping, that he has to apologize to him because not only did he did a twofold thing. Me and my wife were talking about it this morning. Not only did he lie and cheat by, you know, taking performance-enhancing drugs to win those 7 Tour de Frances, but he also, every time someone came and accused him of doing that, he viciously attacked them and sued them, you know, to make them look horrible, to make himself look better. But here's the thing. Every single one of us has done things. Maybe we didn't do performance-enhancing drugs like Lance Armstrong, but we all have our closet. We've all done things. And God says all those things will come out one day. Now, it just so happened that he's reaping what he's sown right now. But we, even if we get by and no one else finds out what our little secret is, the Bible says that we will stand before him one day and everything will be revealed just as it was. This is why it's so important for us to come to Christ and to have our sin forgiven. Paul was also trained under the influence of Gamaliel. He was the most noted rabbi of the time, and Paul appeared to be his top student. His Hebrew name was Saul, Saul of Tarsus, as you know. In the Hebrew, that name means the desired one. The desired one, or the man in demand. Paul came to know Jesus. And when he came to know Jesus, he allowed, and you know, when he first came to know him, he was still called by Saul. And of course, that was his life's goal, because he wanted to be the desired one, the man in demand. But again, after he did come to know Jesus, he chose to go by his Roman name, Paul, which means little one. See, Paul went from the man in demand to the little one. And look how God used the little one. Paul went on to seize his moment in time. He seized it to do great things, not in his strength, but in God's strength. Yes, Paul seized the moment as he had a huge impact on his culture, even though he worked for a living sewing tents. Paul seized the moment as he preached the gospel to all who came in contact with him. Paul seized the moment as he discipled countless men and women to walk with Jesus. Paul seized the moment as he started multiple churches, as he allowed the Holy Spirit of God to inspire him to write two-thirds of the New Testament Bible, the one in which we hold in our hands here today. Yes, with Paul, it was less of me and more of him. His prize was to please God. His motto in life can be summed up in what he said in Philippians chapter 1, verse 21, where he said, "For me to live is Christ, but to die is gain." If I'm going to live in this life, if there's going to be a heartbeat in this chest, if there's going to be lungs and air in my lungs and I'm going to be breathed, I'm going to serve Christ. And when I die, it's gain for me, because I'm going to go home to be with my Lord forever in heaven. Again, Paul didn't come with a superiority of speech, meaning he left out all the big words that some will still use to this day. And why do people use all these big words? To try and impress others. Look how intelligent I am. So I'm going to talk to you with all the big words. And you're listening like, what does that mean? Huh? Have you ever read some theology books and it's all filled with big words? And you know, I'll sit there with a dictionary next to me and I'll be reading. I'm like, what the heck does that word mean? So I'll open it up and I'll read. And I'm like, oh, well, why didn't you just say that? Nobody talks like that. But people talk like that. What? To impress others in our culture with their superiority of speech. Paul could care less if he impressed anyone. This letter that we refer to as 1 Corinthians was written approximately in 55 AD. That means that Paul had been preaching the gospel now for over two decades, some 20 years. Listen to how he started preaching back in Acts chapter 9, verse 22. It says, "But Saul kept increasing in strength and confounding the Jews who lived at Damascus by proving that this Jesus is the Christ." Yes, Paul would use all of his wisdom as a Pharisee, his intellect for being trained under Gamaliel when he was preaching to the Jews. But now, Paul is preaching to Gentiles, non-Jews. And what does he preach? Jesus Christ and him crucified. That doesn't mean that Paul didn't use his great understanding of the Old Testament to minister. And it certainly doesn't mean that we shouldn't study and know our Bible so that we can have answers for those who ask us questions. But Paul wanted to make sure that the people's faith was firmly established in Christ. That's why Paul said in verse 5 that he didn't want people's faith to rest on the wisdom of men, but rather on the power of God. And that's why Paul had a change in speech. I wonder if there's anyone here this morning that needs a change in speech. A change to speak what God desires us to speak to this lost world that we're surrounded in, darkness in. I mean, God wants us to be the voice piece here. I mean, again, God could do a much better job in ministering to the Los Angelinos here by ripping the sky open and putting his Godhead through and saying, I'm God and you're not. But he hasn't chosen to do that. God has chosen to allow us to be his instruments of joy, to spread the gospel message to this world. And God wants us to speak in a way that people can understand. He doesn't want us to use our Christianese or like, hey, bro, like, man, it's all about the blood, you know? It's like, you know, it's like, what? What are you talking about? Talking to someone like, you know, it's like, listen, I want you to know there's a God in heaven that loves you and that he cares about you. But let me just say this, God, he also knows everything you've done and he wants you to come into a relationship with him. Just speaking to people like they need to be spoken to. Hey, listen, the guilt and shame that you have in your life, there's a God that can forgive that. But you have to come to him on his basis. So many times, you know, conversations come up at work and this and that and talking about some kind of wicked sin or something like that. And what do we say? Nothing. We say nothing. Well, we should be standing up and saying, you know what? That's sin. That's wrong. What do you mean it's wrong? It's wrong. The Bible says it's wrong. Oh, you're one of those Christians. Whatever. Let them laugh and say, know this, one day you'll stand before God. It's appointed for each man to die once. It's appointed for each woman to die once. And you will stand before him and you have to give an account of your life. And though they might laugh at you, trust me, that's where God says my word will come back and it will not be void. And that's when that person walks away from you and what sticks in their mind? You're going to stand before God one day. You have to get an account of your life. Because God has written his word upon the fleshly tablets of men's hearts. So even though no one has read this book, that book is written in their hearts because they were created by God. They are not just some evolutionary process that their great-great-grandfather was a chimpanzee, okay? So God has created all of us in his image. And so he has wrote that upon their heart. Which brings up our second point, a change in wisdom. Let's read now again, picking up where we left off, going to verse 6. Yet we do speak wisdom among those who are mature. A wisdom, however, not of this age, nor of the rulers of this age who are passing away. But we speak God's wisdom in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God predestined before the ages to our glory, the wisdom which none of the rulers of this age has understood. For if they had understood it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But just as it is written, things which eye has not seen and ear has not heard, and which have not entered the heart of man, all that God has prepared for those who love him. Wow. Man, we don't even have a clue of what God has prepared for us who he loves. Verse 10, for to us God revealed them through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, even the depths of God. For who among men knows the thoughts of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, the thoughts of God no one knows except the Spirit of God. We'll stop there for a moment. Yes, the wisdom of man is very limited. Man thinks he has it all figured out. Man thinks that he can excommunicate God from our government. Man thinks that you can excommunicate God from our schools. Man thinks we can excommunicate God from our marriage and what our call is to love our wives and for our wives to submit to us men. We think that we can somehow move God out that established marriage, the one who created marriage, and we think that we can excommunicate them from that and everything will still work out just fine in our lives, yet what are we left with? Consider how our country has fallen. Consider what the church has done by not teaching the Word of God. By not teaching the truth of God's Word, we have allowed our world to embrace something that is completely polar opposite of what this country was founded under. America has lost its way. President Obama has reversed the ban on foreign abortions. He did that in the first couple weeks when he was elected the first time. Okay, and then now in Obamacare, he has added in there that we will all have abortion. I want to talk about abortion here just for a moment since we're in Sanctity of Life Month, and this is Sanctity of Life Sunday. Now, some people say, listen, we shouldn't mix religion and politics. Well, I agree with that, but abortion is not politics. It's murder, okay? That's what it is. And it has everything to do with life because God is the creator of all life. Now, some of you are starting to hate me right now. We'll keep that thought for 1 second, okay? Because along with us having to, do this, our tax dollars are being used to finance abortions, whether we like it or not. Now, it's been 40 years this year since Roe versus Wade was overcome in the Supreme Court, and that we have used, where it's become legal to have an abortion. Now, according to the Guttmacher Institute, they report that there's 1.2 million abortions last year. And we hear the cry of it's a woman's right, it's a woman's right. What about the right of the unborn child inside of that woman's womb? See, advances in medical technology make the personhood of the fetus undeniable. It can't just be like it was back then, because I remember when this was legally put forth. Oh, it's just tissue. It's just tissue. Not right now, at 6 weeks along, there is a body. There is arms, legs, and eyes are forming in that fetus at 6 weeks along. They have detected heartbeats in babies at as early as 4 weeks now. This is not some tissue. This is not just a little blob in there. This is a life that is growing inside of a woman. And as woman's right is becoming more questionable now as it is being forcibly challenged by the unborn child's right to life. Doesn't that child have a right to life? We made abortion legal on the back of rape and incest. In fact, the whole Roe versus Wade, the Roe part of that was for Norma McCorvey. And she claimed that she was gang raped in order to gain sympathy of the court so that she could have an abortion, which was a lie. She was not gang raped, but they used that. And her attorney knew that as she argued that before the Supreme Court, she knew that it was a lie. Norma McCorvey came out in 1988 and admitted that it was a lie. And in 1995, she became part of the pro-life movement. So the whole thing was based on a lie. Now, the Guttmacher Institute said that the rape and incest of abortions, which is how we've gotten this thing hauled to become law, is 0.33% of 1%. Less than one-third of 1% is because of rape and incest. That means that all abortions, the other 99.67% of all abortions, are not because of rape and incest. It is just simply taking the life of the baby. I think we need to stop kidding ourselves because abortion is all about the money. Planned Parenthood is an over $1 billion a year business. I mean, do the math on this. 1.2 million abortions a year times the cheapest abortion is like $399 at the earliest stage. It goes up to $2,500, $3,000, $3,500, $5,000 more depending on how late the abortion's done. 1.2 million times $399, $499, $899, whatever the number is that it averages out to be, and it's over $1 billion a year. Psalm 139:13, God said this, He formed us in our mother's wombs. He formed us in our inward parts, and He wove us together in our mother's womb. And see, us as Christians, somewhere along we have to make a stand for this, because if we think for 1 second that God's not going to bring a judgment upon America for what we've done, we've killed over 50 million babies in abortion. I mean, think about the staggering number that is. Al Gore, talking about the rainforest, was saying how, I can't believe we're killing the rainforest, and just think about all the birds that are not living. What songs are these birds not going to sing? Well, what about what songs are all these 50 million babies not singing? It's not that I don't care about the birds of the rainforest. I mean, come on, I don't want to destroy our planet either. But it's like, have we not misplaced what's important in this life? See, it was Adolf Hitler in the 30s. Germany was living in a mass depression. Why? Because they started World War I, and the world had turned their back on Germany. Then finally, Adolf Hitler stands up and says, oh, hey, you know, it's like, I've got a new way. And he started bringing prosperity, and he started telling these German people, you are the chosen race. You are the people of destiny. You people. And all of a sudden, people started believing what he was saying. Well, then what was he starting to do? He was starting to cut all the social programs, get rid of all the disabled, get rid of all the handicapped, get rid of these people that are pulling us down as a society because we are a chosen people or what have you. And he was killing these people. Listen, all the German people had to turn their eyes away from what he was doing. They might have said, well, that's not right. I don't think you should kill the people in wheelchairs. I don't think you should, you know, but it's like they didn't say anything. Why? Because they were, for the first time in their generation, they were experiencing prosperity. They were experiencing all these things. So they turned their eyes away. Then Hitler said, hey, we're going to get rid of all these Jews because they're the dregs of the earth. And so he killed 6 million Jews. And what did the German people do? They turned their eyes away. They didn't look. There's a judgment that came. There's a judgment that came on their country. What did they lose? The Germans lost everything. Everything. Because they reaped what they sowed. And it came back upon them. And those people, the people of the cities there, had to go into these concentration camps and they had to clean up and they seen what happened afterwards. See, we as a people, as God's people, we have to stand up for these things. We have to stand up. We have to vote against these things. We have to vote for people that are doing the right thing. Our country is facing many problems. Yet I wonder how many of them stem back to our abandonment of the principles of God's word. You know, there's a few things in the Bible. Sin is sin in the Bible. You know, you steal something, that's sin. Commit adultery, that's sin. But there's a few things in the Bible that just rakes God's, he just rakes him over the coals. I mean, because he gets angry. And one of those things in the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy is when you kill the babies. Because they would take live babies and offer them up as a sacrifice to the god of Moloch. God would destroy those nations. He would wreak it on them. He would wipe them out. Everybody that was there because of the sacrificing of live babies, you know, on the altar to the god of Moloch. Don't think for a second that we are going to be, you know, set apart from this when we have allowed, we've turned a deaf eye. It's like, oh, well, it's the mother's rights. It's like, mother's rights. Remember this woman in New York that came up to me and wanted me to sign her petition for abortion. I said, I would never do that. And she's like, why? And I said, because as you're killing a baby. She goes, I can't believe you. You're probably some Christian. She started yelling at me. And I said, how old are you? She's like, 45. I said, do you have any children? She goes, yes, I have a son. I said, how can you as a woman who have that baby, that watch that baby grow inside of you and give birth to that baby and nurse that baby, how can you say that that wasn't a life inside of you? She's like, oh, I can't believe you're a bigot. And she walked away from me. I'm like, well, where's the other side of this? Remember, our country was founded on our faith in God and the principles of the Bible. It was our sixth president, John Quincy Adams, the son of the second president of the United States, John Adams, that said this quote, the first and almost only book deserving of universal attention is the Bible. It was our 16th president, Abraham Lincoln, that said this quote, all the good from the Savior of the world is communicated through this book. But for the Bible, we could not know right from wrong. All the things desirable to a man are contained in it. God help us when we stand before Him one day. Since Americans have voted to legalize abortion 40 years ago, again, this country's aborted over 50 million babies. That's one-third of all live births since it started. These are all little lives that would have become American citizens. But unfortunately, they were cut short from the very womb that God had placed them in. Again, it was God that said in Isaiah 44:24, thus says the Lord your Redeemer and the one who formed you from the womb. He says, I am the Lord, the maker of all things, stretching out the heavens by myself and spreading out the earth all alone. I just want to finish this little side trip here for some of you here, you know, that have maybe had an abortion or you know someone that had abortion. I mean, please come out to this movie tonight. You know, let's have a time of, you know, just going before the Lord and everything. And I really encourage you to come out. But I want you to know if you have had personally an abortion, I want you to know that there's forgiveness. That's why Jesus died on the cross. Because we've done things that are really wretched and we've done things that are wrong. And God is the only one who can provide forgiveness, not only for the woman, but the man who was part of that decision. There's forgiveness to be had. And I want to say this also. If you had an abortion, you have a child waiting for you in heaven. Because that baby was immediately taken into the presence of God, and those 50 million plus babies are all in heaven with new bodies, and they're surrounding the throne of the King of Kings and worshiping Him daily. And so know this, God is going to reunite you with either your son or your daughter, and God has them there in His presence, and they're protected, and they've been taken care of, and they've been raised well. So if you have done that, and if you haven't, and you don't know Christ as your Savior, come to Him, seek His forgiveness, and God can not only forgive you for having an abortion, but He can heal the memories of that abortion in your life. Just know that He's the only one that can wipe away every tear when it comes to those things. Yes, man's wisdom has led us astray. He's led us away from God, His will, and God's desire to live both in and through us. But know this, Paul says in verse 11 that only the Holy Spirit of God knows the thoughts of God. And the Spirit of God has recorded His thoughts in the Bible. It says in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20, but know this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever made by an act of human will, but men moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. Yes, the Spirit of God has given to us the teaching of the past, and He has also given us the promises for our future, and He's given them to us in His Word, and we have the ability of understanding these things because He's given us His Holy Spirit to lead us, to guide us, and direct us until we step into His presence. Yes, we need a change of wisdom, and it cannot come from anything in this world. It can only come from above, which brings up our third and final point, a change in spirit. Let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. He says, now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things freely given to us by God, which things we also speak, not in words taught by human wisdom, but in those taught by the Spirit, combining spiritual thoughts with spiritual words. But a natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them because they are spiritually appraised. And he who is spiritually appraises all things, yet he himself is appraised by no man. For who has known the mind of the Lord that he should instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. Wow. Notice verse 12. Is that not amazing? God has filled each and every one of us with the Spirit of God. We have the Holy Spirit of God living inside of us. This is crazy. I love that verse in 1 Corinthians 3:16. We'll get there in chapter 3. But he says, you know, so do you not know that you're the temple of God and the Spirit of God dwells in you? It's like, think about that. In the entire Old Testament, there was only a handful of men that had the Spirit of the living God fall upon them. I mean, it was David, of course, right? You know, the prophet Samuel came in, anointed his head with oil, and the Holy Spirit of God came upon him. What's the next thing we read about David? There he is in the Valley of Elah with Mr. Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum, giant Goliath. And he takes Goliath, the giant, down 9 foot 6 inches tall. Then he went out there in the valley and says, man, you can't speak about my God the way you're speaking. And Goliath's looking at the little boy David like, what am I, a dog? You send some little kid out here to fight me? I've been coming out here for a month, every morning, every evening, challenging the mighty warrior of God's army, of the Israeli army, the Jewish army. Not one man has stood up. And after a month, this is what I deserve? You send some little kid out here? Some little, just little puny little kid? He goes, guess what, kid? I'm going to feed you to the birds. That's when David said, well, listen here, Mr. Fee-Fi-Fo. Okay, hey, how about this? You can't talk to my God that way, you uncircumcised Philistine. I'm going to take you and your entire army and feed it to the birds. How about that? And that's when he ran after them. I could see Goliath like, who is this kid? And he's like, I'm just going to rip your skin off. And Dave was running at him thinking like, what? I'm going to pinch his face off like a zit, you know? And Dave was running like, and he takes his little stone and flings his stone. I can see God taking that stone. Yeah, let me, I need to speed that up a little bit. As that stone planted itself into the brain of Mr. Fee-Fi-Fo, and he just, bam, hit the ground dead. Could you imagine all the Philistines that were watching, like, hey, look at the little kid. It's like, man, they're like, ah! And they all just ran. They ran. Yes, God, the Holy Spirit, lives inside of us. Why? That we might know the things freely given to us by God. God does not keep us in the dark. He has revealed to us his plans. God reveals to us his purposes right here in his word. Obviously, there are certain things that are simply not, that we are not going to know. I don't know why certain harsh things happen. I don't know why this happened or that happened. I don't know. Deuteronomy 29:29 says that the secret things of the Lord are the Lord's. But all these things that happen, we have to wait sometimes until we get to heaven. You know, why is life so hard at times? I don't know. Why is evil given such what seems to be such a long leash to work in our lives? I don't know. Look, I'm sure that there are many other questions that we could come up with. I don't know the answers to all these things, but let's stick with the things that we do know. Get this. We can know God. We can know him. I mean, not just like know of him. We can know him. We can have a relationship with the creator of the universe. We can know what his will is. We can know what he likes. We can know what he desires. We can have hope in him while living in a world that has lost its hope. We hold all those answers right in our hands, right here in this book. And the Bible gives us a detailed account of the last days, of when he's going to return again, of the times and the seasons that will precede the coming of the end. And they are detailed in many parts of the Bible. We've studied these because we're living in that time right now, namely Matthew 24, Luke 17, 1 Thessalonians 4 and 5, Ezekiel 37, 38, and 39, and most especially the book of Revelation, the Apocalypse. Right there, he has given it to us where we can see the detailed account of what will happen when the Antichrist is revealed, the one world government, a one world cashless society. All of these things are described to us in detail throughout the book of Revelation. Yes, we have received the Spirit of God. He lives inside of every true believer. Now our eyes, the eyes of our soul, can see what he wants us to see. The ears of our heart can hear what God wants us to hear now. Think about that. We have to drink that into our soul. We can know these things. We can come before the God of heaven in church, in our homes, anywhere we are, and we can open his word, the Bible. Yes, as we seek his face with an expectant heart, we can hear from the living God. And how again does God speak to us? Well, by and far, the majority of the time, God will speak through his written word, the Bible. It's inspired. Listen to the promise that Jesus gave us in John 15:7. He says, if you abide in me, if you do that, this will happen. If you don't, it won't. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you can ask whatever you wish and it'll be done for you. I don't care if you're 2 weeks old in the Lord. I don't care if you've been a Christian for, 20 years. That's a great verse. If we abide in him and his word abides in us, meaning we're seeking his word, we're asking things based upon what we know his word has given to us, we can have those things, he says. Know this, the Bible is a treasure chest of promises for every true believer. It's not for those who only follow by mouth and not by how they live. That's why Paul said in verse 14 that the unbeliever will never understand God. He's never going to get it. Why? It says the natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, which of course is the Bible. It says they are spiritually appraised. The King James uses the word spiritually discerned. And what that means is this: humanity on our own, we do not have the capacity to understand the spiritual things of God. Have you ever shared with Christ with someone and they're intently listening and they just don't get it? They're just not getting it. See, before Christ, we were all the same way. The Bible makes it very clear. It's only through the illumination of His Word by the Holy Spirit of God that someone can come to know Christ. And that's why we have a prayer meeting before every service, a half hour before the service starts, up in the room right up here. And people are praying that when you come here, that God would speak to you. That God would like cause you to understand the things that are being spoken. That's why I pray before every message. Okay, let's pray before we get into God's Word. God, speak to us. Cause these things to be relevant to us here today. For none of us can know the things of God without the Spirit of God revealing them to us. But when He does, it's like someone turning on a floodlight in a dark dungeon, is it not? It's like, oh, I didn't see that before. And all of a sudden, the clarity comes in. Know this, there are many that live in many different lifestyles. People that claim to know God, yet their very lifestyle is in opposition to God's Word. And they don't agree with that part. Oh, I don't agree with that part. I don't believe in that part. I'm living this lifestyle. My culture tells me it's okay to do this. So I live in this life. Doesn't everybody do it? It's like, you don't agree with what God's Word says? You should change what you are doing. Because God's Word never changes. God never changes. What was sin 3,000 years ago, guess what? It's still sin today. What was sin 1,000 years ago is still sin today. It doesn't matter what our culture is doing. Our culture is anti-Christ. Our culture is against God. Remember, we excommunicated God from our government. We don't do things like what the Bible says anymore. And just because things have changed in these last, 30 to 40 years doesn't mean God's Word ever changed. See, these people will claim to love God, but this is what Jesus said in John 14:15. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. So don't tell me you love me. Oh, I love God, but I'm living in this sinful lifestyle. It's like, well, hold on. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep his commandments. So you can say whatever you want to say, but if you're living in sin, you don't love God. The Bible also says in 1 John 1:6, if we say that we have fellowship with him, yet we walk in darkness, we lie, and the truth is not in us. I am a Christian. I go to church. Guess what? If you're living in sin, you lie, and the truth is not in you. See, it's a difference between you're struggling with this area. Oh, this, oh God, this area, I keep falling. Oh, God, I hate this thing. That's different. See, you're struggling with an area. God's going to get you through that. It's different between that and I'm just living in this area. Woo-hoo. Pull the party poppers. Woo-hoo. La Vida Luca. It's just like, see, that's like God saying, look, you don't know me. You can say all you want, you know me. Guess what? You don't know me. But I'm claiming this. Doesn't matter what you claim. You're not getting it. It's not going to happen because you are living in sin. If you're here this morning and this is speaking to you and you hate me right now, you hate me for the other things I said this morning. You hate me about the abortion thing. Should be talking about that from the pulpit. You're stretching out your limitations here. It's like, listen, if you hate me right now, don't hate me. I'm just the messenger. Hate God. You want to hate God? You hate him. If he's like, listen, I'm going to do abortion no matter what. I'm going to support it. I'm going to vote for all those. Okay, then that's between you and God. But guess what? Your problem's with him. It's not with me. Because I'm not giving my opinion up here. I'm giving you God's opinion from up here. So don't hate me. You are hating God and his revealed truth. Look at how the chapter ends here in 1 Corinthians 2:16 again. He says, for who has known the mind of the Lord that he should instruct him? Who are we to instruct God? He says, but we have the mind of Christ. But we can't instruct God. Yes, if there's a problem, then we are the ones that need to change in our spirit. We need God's spirit to change our spirit. I'd like to close with this verse in Lamentations 3:39. It says, why should any living mortal or any man offer complaint in view of his sins? Like, how can we sit there and say, hey, God, I don't like this, whatever. You know, it's like, how can we do that in view of our own sins? You know, Robert De Niro was quoted as saying, like, hey, what if you get, you die and you stand before God, if there's a heaven, what are you going to say to God? I'm going to say you got a lot of explaining to do. Really? Really? You're going to stand before God and the holy angels as a cherubim are flying around the throne of God crying out, holy, 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 with millions of angels singing, with all the God's people, you know, bowing before his throne, and you're going to stand up and say, hey, you got a lot of explaining to do. Really? No, I don't think so. You're going to fall on your face and you're going to say, oh, Jesus Christ was Lord. And you're going to say it, and then he's going to send you out into the pit of hell because you never followed him. See, and God doesn't want that. He doesn't want that. That's why he goes on in Lamentations 3:40, the very next verse, and he says, let us examine and probe our ways and let us return to the Lord. Stop blaming God. And start humbling yourself. Let's pray. Father, we just come before you, Lord. Thank you so much for your word here this morning, Lord. And Father, I just want to take this time here, Lord. And we talked about a lot of things today. And maybe, Lord, I'm sure that the Holy Spirit has brought up things in your life. Areas of sin that maybe you've succumbed to. Maybe there's some here that have aborted their babies. And maybe you're just like sitting here and you're rehashing those thoughts in your mind right now. And my heart just goes out to you. And I'm so sorry that you're in this place and position. But if you know Christ, I just want to encourage you again. God loves you. He died on the cross for you. He cares about you. And the Bible says that there's no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. And I want you to know that God has forgiven you. And he's cleansed you of this sin. And he's wiped it away. And your baby's waiting for you. And you will see that baby. But if you're here this morning, and you've never come into that real born-again relationship with Christ, doesn't matter if you grew up in a denomination, doesn't matter if you're a Catholic or a Baptist or a Lutheran or whatever, it doesn't matter. Do you know Christ? Are you born again? The Bible says, Jesus speaking, you must be born again to enter the kingdom of heaven. That term born again just means born from above, that your spirit is reborn. Your body is not going to go to heaven or hell. Your body is going to go into a grave one day, but your spirit is going to go to heaven or hell. And Jesus says your spirit must be born again. It can only happen through the denial of your own life and coming to God and saying, I repent of my sin. I'm sorry. I'm sorry for the things that I've done. And if you